I'm Gloria Palmer. I'm the Executive Director of Green Mountain Academy for Lifelong Learning. And we are here tonight for a lecture that is part of our Hot Topics series. And with great pleasure, it is great to have Dr. Stephen Sinding here to make this presentation. Dr. Sinding has been with us before, but for those of you who have not heard him give a lecture, I will tell you a little bit about him. He began his career in 1971 at the U.S. Agency for International Development. Following assignments in Washington, Pakistan, and the Philippines, Dr. Sinding served for 3 years as director of the USAID Office of Population. From 1986 to 1990, he was the director of USAID's mission to Kenya. Following his 20-year career with USAID, Dr. Sinding served for a year as senior population advisor to the World Bank, and then moved to the Rockefeller Foundation, where until 1999 he was director of the Population Sciences Program. From 1999 to 2002, he was a clinical professor of public health at Columbia University. He was the director general of the International Planned Parenthood Federation in London from 2002 to his retirement in 2006. He is currently a senior fellow of the Guttmacher Institute. He serves on a number of boards and works as an international consultant. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Stephen Sinding.
Thank you very much, Gloria. It's a pleasure to be back at this podium with such a wonderful audience. I know I'm competing tonight. Green Mountain Academy is competing tonight with a joint program of Hildene and the Dorset Theater Festival on the Lincoln-Douglas debate. So that you're here and not there at least makes me very grateful. thank you for coming. Last year, I talked in very broad terms about what's going on globally in population. It was entitled kind of Whatever Happened to the Population Explosion. And just about everybody in this room is old enough to remember when that was the hot topic. It was something that, as a nation, we worried about, global leaders worried about it. Huge amounts of resources were mobilized to deal with it. And it was, frankly, what attracted me to this field. As a college senior, I heard a lecture by one of our professors on the population explosion that excited me. As at a time, Kennedy was president, or had been until very recently, and I was very much a part of the generation that was called to public service, and I thought if there was something I could work on that would address that problem, that would be a wonderful thing to be able to do. And I have to say, it has been a wonderful thing to be able to do. And what I'd like to talk to you about tonight is kind of how this remarkable international effort unfolded, particularly in Asia, and what its implications have been for the economic miracle that much of Asia has been and continues to experience. There has been great debate among economists for many, many years about whether population really has anything to do with the economic performance of nations. And we'll come to that. But that really is at the heart of what I want to talk about. And then to talk toward the end about what the implications of this might be, not only for Asia, although what's happening there demographically continues to be tremendously interesting and not necessarily positive from an economic development standpoint, but also what the implications are for Africa and the remaining parts of the world which we could still legitimately call less developed or underdeveloped. But let's begin with just a little bit of a review of where we were. This will come back. The last time. For those of you who weren't here last time, I'd like to review just a little bit of demographic history. Before I do that, though, I'm going to show you our twins. this is my wallpaper on my computer, and they just are about next week to celebrate their first birthday. But enough of that. I want to begin by giving you kind of a stylized view of what demographers call the demographic transition and spend a few minutes talking about what this is. And I know that you can't read the words on that, and it doesn't really matter, because what I want to talk about is what the curves mean and what these pyramids at the bottom are all about, because we're going to spend a fair amount of time toward the end of this talk talking about the pyramids. I also want to say I want to limit my remarks to no more than an hour, and I hope less than that, so we'll have lots of time for discussion. And I'm willing to talk about anything that has to do with population. We don't have to talk just about Asia. We don't have to talk just about this talk. If there are things on your mind about other issues in the field, I'm happy to talk about whatever is on your mind. But let's talk about the demographic transition just for a minute. These two curves, the lower one, the heavier one, represents the death rate historically. And the upper one, the less dark one, the birth rate, or the fertility rate, as demographers call it. What happens in what demographers call the demographic transition is that you move from a steady state equilibrium with no population growth to speak of, where both death rates and birth rates are very high. Birth rates are high because they have to be in order to replace the number of people, particularly young people, who die. When infant mortality is very high, as it is in the traditional society, birth rates have to be high in order to for a population of any kind, of any species, to sustain itself. And the human species is no different from others. But what happened in the human species is that we began to discover interventions through public health, agriculture, water supply, and generally the advancement of science that led to dramatic declines in the death rate. That happened first, of course, in today's industrialized countries, in the West primarily. And it took about a century from the mid-17th century until the mid-19th century the mid-18th century for birth rates to follow death rates down to a new low-level equilibrium where, again, you have population stabilization. And, of course, what happens between the decline of the death rate and the lag and subsequent decline of the birth rate is the population grows. And it grows fastest, the faster the death rate falls, and the longer the gap between the fall in the death rate and the fall in the birth rate. This is the classical definition of the demographic transition, and it is related to lots of different things. I mean, we know that it takes a while, once the death rate falls in any society, for people to realize that their children will not die, and therefore to change their fertility strategies, to begin to have fewer children in order to keep the number that they would like to survive to adulthood to a reasonable number. And for most people in the traditional society, that's around 5 or 6 kids. And I have to tell you a story that I may have told last year, but it's my favorite story about how I came to understand the demographic transition. And it's when Monica and I and our family were in Pakistan, and I was a brand new population officer in the field. My first overseas exposure to this problem. And I went out on a field trip into the rural areas of Punjab province in Pakistan. And we went and we visited a farmer. And in the course of the conversation, the farmer was asked, how many children do you have? And he said, well, I have 6. And the person I was with said, well, do you want to have 6 children? And he said, well, I need to have 6 children. He said, I have 3 sons and I have 3 daughters. I have 1 son to work with me on the land and to inherit the land when I grow old. I have a 2nd son who goes to Lahore and earns money to help support the family because I need that additional income to keep the farm going. And I have a 3rd son in case something happens to one of the first 2. And he said, and Allah gave me three daughters. And there you have the six-child family in the traditional agricultural society. That's essentially the story of the demographic transition. As death rates among children go down, as you can be assured of the survival, you tend to have fewer. As urbanization proceeds, you tend to need fewer. As education rises, women want alternatives to childbearing. And as employment opportunities for women increase, the same thing happens. So with modernization, the birth rate gradually follows the death rate down. And that is the demographic transition. In the earliest stage of the demographic transition, what we call the population pyramid looks like this. And the pyramid is nothing more than the girls on one side and the boys on the other, with the line down the middle, and five-year age cohorts going up, so that you've got very large numbers of people at the bottom and very small numbers of people at the top. And what happens is that with high death rates, the size in each cohort diminishes fairly rapidly, so that by the time you get to 45, you've got only a very small cohort compared to what you have in the first 5 or 10 years of life. As the thing moves forward, it gets thicker at the top as people survive to older ages and larger numbers of people survive to middle and old age. And as the birth rate begins to decline, you get a little bit of a narrowing down at the bottom. In the later stages of the transition, it begins to square off toward the bottom as birth rates go down and life expectancy rises. And then in the late stages of the transition, once you're at stabilization, you get something that looks more or less vertical with the numbers of people in each age cohort being more or less the same. Now, this shape has tremendous implications for what I'm going to say later about what happened in Asia. But let's go back now and talk a little bit about Asia itself. What, as I mentioned, John.
Just a question. So that last pyramid, what's happening there is that they're having fewer children, right? But they're living longer, and so you get more like a column effect.
That's exactly right. They're having fewer children, they're living longer, and so you have many more people in the old ages. And what happens is that you go from, well, I'm getting ahead of the story. The punchline has to do with what this means for economic development, and I'm not going to give that one away right away. Well, as I said, it took about a century for the West to go through this transition. It took Asia, most of the Asian tigers, the most successful economies of East Asia, a generation. In other words, a quarter of the time it took the West to go through that transition. Why the difference? Well, I would argue that a very powerful part of the difference was a combination of very strong public policies that said we need to have fewer children, we need to have smaller families, and strong family planning programs that made it possible for couples to exercise that policy option. There was very little coercion, actually, but there was a lot of moral suasion, a lot of pressure that governments put on people to have fewer children. Why did they do this? Well, first of all, in the 1950 round of censuses, the United Nations Statistical Division discovered for the first time that there was a real population explosion going on in Asia. That following the Second World War, the introduction of public health measures brought down death rates very rapidly. Birth rates were still very high. In Korea in 1950, before the Korean War started, the birth rate was about 6.5 or 7 children per family. And the death rate in the years just before the Korean War dropped precipitously so that child survival went from 1 in every 3 births ending in death to about 1 in every 15 births ending in death. And that precipitous decline in the death rate, which occurred across the entire developing world, but particularly in East and Southeast Asia, it happened there first, really brought on the realization of a population explosion that was going on around the world. And the countries of East Asia were the first to recognize this. They actually were not the first to recognize it. They were the first to effectively act upon it. The first to recognize it were India and Pakistan. And in 1952, India initiated the first national population policy. It was a total failure. Pakistan followed a few years later with a national population policy that was equally disastrous. Both countries utterly failed in their population policies for a variety of reasons, some of which had to do with what that farmer told me. He had no incentive as long as mortality was still high, and it was in South Asia, to control the number of births that his wife had, furthermore, the government programs were utterly inept. They were carried out through public fiat. In India, the only method of family planning available was sterilization. Temporary methods of birth control were not made available at all. Of course, people who thought there was any chance their children would die would not be interested in sterilization. The result is that years later, the Indian government resorted to compulsory sterilization, which was a disastrous policy that brought down the government of Indira Gandhi. The experience of the South Asian countries was a disaster for family planning. I'm going to come back to that theme in a minute. But in East Asia, things were different. The first country that really showed the way was Japan. Japan had a baby boom immediately following the war, starting really in 46 and early 47, and carrying through to about 1949, at which point the government realized that it had a real population explosion on its hands, and it needed to do something about that. And the Japanese liberalized abortion laws and made contraception publicly available through the public health system, and showed that a good family planning program with public support could have a real impact on the birth rate. And the Japanese birth rate just plummeted, starting around 1953-54, and continued for years and years after that to the present day. Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong looked at the Japanese experience and said, aha, the Japanese are onto something. Maybe we ought to be doing the same thing. And all four of those societies, with strong governments, with relatively stable political systems, albeit in each case somewhat authoritarian political systems, instituted strong family planning programs within good public health systems, and were determined to bring their birth rates down. Now, I'm not going to stand here and try to make the argument before you that bringing the birth rate down is the key to economic development. It's not. I would argue that it is, in situations of very high fertility, a necessary condition, but it is not sufficient. It has to be accompanied by a whole program of policies that reinforce the stimulus to economic growth. In the case of East Asia, that program included a major investment in education and a major investment in public health. They kept kids alive. They put kids in school. They really emphasized education in a way that few societies other than our own a century earlier had ever done. The combination of bringing down the birth rate and making sure the children would survive and educating them properly, along with a set of pro-growth economic policies, largely export promotion strategies for industry with strong government support, was the package, the formula, the cocktail that the Asian countries followed with significant success. So, as I say, Taiwan and Korea were among the first. Singapore and Hong Kong followed that, and you had this virtuous circle. Because what happens, of course, is economic prosperity rises, people start moving off the farms into the city, into the factories, employment opportunities for women open up, and the incentives to have fewer children become very powerful. Kids are a net asset on the farm. They become a net liability in an urban setting. You have to pay for their education. They don't contribute to household income until they're out of school and into their own careers. And you put into place a pension and social security system so you don't depend on your children for old age security. All of those things are urban innovations that didn't exist in the pre-industrial agrarian society, where children were just essential for both labor on the farm and as a source of old age security. Well, that brings us to the present day. And if you look across East Asia today, there are really only two or three exceptions to the generalization that this region is in the midst of a tremendous economic boom, a boom unlike any seen since the Industrial Revolution in the West and what followed it in North America. Following Korea, Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong was Thailand, then Malaysia, now Indonesia, and Vietnam, which has one of the fastest growing economies in the world at the moment. I think Cambodia will be on this track very soon. There's every indication that that's underway. Myanmar is just coming out of its shell, and I suspect that in time Myanmar will join the Tigers. And Laos, those are the lagging countries, and the Philippines. Now, the Philippines is a really interesting case. It's the only Roman Catholic country in which the church plays a really powerful role in government. And the church has made it essentially impossible for political leaders to play the kind of role with respect to family planning and fertility regulation in the Philippines that they have in other Asian countries. And the difference between the Philippines and Indonesia, or the Philippines and Thailand, is largely the difference between a five-child family and a two-and-a-half-child family, or a two-child family. Because otherwise, the Philippines has an education system that produces well-educated people to come into the workforce. It has many of the ingredients that the other Asian countries have. Indeed, it came out of World War II with advantages over most of them in that regard. But because they have been unable and unwilling to address the population question, I would argue they have suffered tremendously in competition with their Asian neighbors. Every country that has controlled its fertility in East and Southeast Asia has prospered economically. And those that have lagged economically are those that have not managed to do that. Is there a causal relationship? We're going to come to that question. Right now, let's just say it's a very strong association that smells as if it might be causal. South Asia is an interesting contrast to that, because South Asia really, as I mentioned, India and Pakistan and Nepal didn't do so well in that regard. Sri Lanka did, but Sri Lanka is another kind of case. But a very interesting case is Bangladesh, and I'm going to come to that in a few minutes. After Bangladesh left Pakistan, its demographic situation changed quite dramatically. Now, let me change gears for just a moment and talk about the two great debates that have animated the population field from the beginning, from the 1950s right up to the present day. One of them is the debate about what I call the debate about how, and the other is the debate about whether. The debate about how is basically the question, do family planning programs work? And as I mentioned earlier, there was a lot of skepticism, particularly among demographers in the early years, that family planning programs could be effective in settings in which literacy was low, education was poor, infant mortality was high, and most incomes were earned through subsistence agriculture. Demographers looked at the situation across much of the developing world, and they said, You know, as long as these structural conditions exist, it's virtually impossible to imagine that these countries could ever have effective family planning programs, because people act in their own best interest. High fertility is something that people do because most of them are like that Pakistani farmer. Most of them have large families because they need to have large families. And until you change that dynamic, you're not going to be able to get very far with family planning programs. And there was real skepticism. And this was strongly reinforced, the skepticism, by the big, large-scale failures of the Indian and Pakistan programs of the 1950s and the 1960s. And I have to say, when we lived in Pakistan, I became convinced by the time I left in 1978, when the Pakistan program was still producing no appreciable impact, that these demographers were right, that family planning was just not going to be effective in these kinds of societies. But then I went back to Washington and I got a job in the Asia Bureau and had an opportunity to go and look at the programs in East and Southeast Asia. And I began to change my mind. I began to see that there was a big difference between the attitudes of the Pakistani farmers of the world and their wives. The fact is that those women did not want to have 8 and 9 and 10 pregnancies to ensure the survival of 6 or 7 children. They, in fact, were worn out by the time they were 25 years old, and they didn't want to have any more children after they had had their 5th or their 6th. There was a strong latent demand for family planning, and governments that provided family planning services that really responded effectively to what those women wanted were seeing real effect, real impact. The demographic transition started in Korea and Taiwan, and I saw it in Indonesia, not because incomes were rising and industry was taking off, but because governments were getting family planning services to women in a way that those women wanted those services. It was more the fertility decline enabling the economic policies to be effective than the other way around. But as I said, once that process starts, it's a virtuous circle. They reinforce one another. Once fertility comes down and industrialization or economic development begins really to take off, all the incentives to have fewer children begin to kick in, and it becomes a circular, self-reinforcing system, and that's essentially what has happened. That didn't happen in South Asia in the way that it did in East and Southeast Asia, except, as I mentioned, in Bangladesh, because one of the other countries that I went to when I had this job back in the Asia Bureau in Washington was Bangladesh, and I saw there that with a really strong government emphasis, with plenty of resources coming in from the outside, that they were able in Bangladesh to provide services in a way that really responded to what women wanted. And their husbands, in many cases, didn't want the women doing this. I mean, a lot of the family planning that was going on in the Philippines, in Indonesia and in Bangladesh and elsewhere, was surreptitious. And in fact, the injectable contraceptive, which is now increasingly available in Africa, is having a revolutionary effect on that, because it's hard to hide the packet of pills in a mud hut. It's not hard to hide an injection that you get once a month where your husband doesn't know you're getting it. And so the improvement in contraceptive technologies that enabled women to contracept and to keep that knowledge hidden from their husbands until their husbands were prepared to come along with them in this fertility control strategy was very important in what happened in much of Asia. In Taiwan, there are wonderful stories about women's clubs where they pretended to be going off to produce handicrafts together and have literacy classes. And in fact, what they were doing was family planning. Of course, once it starts, the word spreads like wildfire among women about where you can get it and how it works. that works both ways. If side effects are a problem, and a few women have bad side effects, that can ruin a program overnight. So that one of the other things we learned is how important it is to have a broad range of methods available, something the Indian government to this day has not learned. And so these nuances were important. But what happened in that first great debate, the debate about how, was that the skepticism of the demographers, based on their theories of what happens in households and their observation of India and Pakistan programs, began to break down in the face of the real successes that were happening in East and Southeast Asia and in Bangladesh. Bangladesh was a basket case. Henry Kissinger told us that. He said in, 1972, that Bangladesh was an international basket case. The poorest country on earth, a place that had no chance. Is there any way of getting some air in here? Can we open a door or a window or something else? And so by, I would say, the mid-1980s, the tide had turned in favor of the family planners, the people who said, get the services out there and people will use them. Build it and they will come. And it worked in country after country, even in India, where when we lived in South Asia, the Indian birth rate was around 5.5 children per woman. Today it's about 2.5. So even in India, it has gradually declined. The outliers at this point in Asia are really only, I would say Pakistan and Laos are about the only countries left, and Burma, Myanmar, where family planning is not really strongly entrenched and with strong effects. The second debate, the debate about whether, has been a much more complicated debate, because notwithstanding what I said earlier about my own hunch that this association between economic development and fertility decline looks causal to me, economists have been very, very skeptical. They've said association is not causality, and they pointed to years and years of research which showed no real association between a country's gross national product and its birth rate. You had countries all over the place. You had Cuba and Sri Lanka with very low birth rates and with negative or stagnant economic growth. And you had countries like Saudi Arabia with very high population growth rates and very strong rates in economic growth. But what began to change that debate was the insight of a group of Harvard economists. David Bloom, Jeffrey Williamson, David Canning are names that are not household names, but these are the guys who began to look underneath these aggregate numbers and say, why is it that the countries of Southeast Asia were able to have so much more rapid economic growth and so much more rapid fertility decline than even the Western industrialized superpowers? And they said the secret to this really is age distribution. And that's where I want to come back to the pyramids. And this will get us toward the conclusions of this talk. How do I get out of this? There. Oh, I did actually just very quickly want to show you this slide, which just gives you an idea of how fast this fertility decline in East Asia was. This is TFR, the total fertility rate. One child, two children, three children, four children, five children per family. In 1965, you had five or six children per family in Hong Kong, Korea, Singapore, and Taiwan. By 1988, which is less than a generation, 23 years, it had fallen from 5.5 kids to under 2 children per woman in those societies. I mean, dramatic decline.
When you talk about Korea, are you talking about both
South
Korea?
South.
Okay.
Only South Korea. The People's Republic of Korea is a whole different story.
Yeah, I would have thought so.
What the Harvard guys did was they began to look at age distribution, and what they hypothesized was that at the in the pre-industrial, pre-modernization, traditional society where you've got a pyramid that looks like that, with 50 or more percent of the population under the age of 15, you've got a tremendous age dependency problem. You've got a relatively small workforce between the ages, say, of 15 and 45, trying to support an enormous number of people under the age of 15. And if a country is trying to modernize, if it's trying to build an education system, if it's trying to build a health system, if it's trying to build any kind of a social network, the costs of that kind of a situation are just overwhelming, because that workforce, no matter how productively employed, can't begin to support that enormously large population at the base in a way that that produces any kind of momentum and growth. So they said the reason that reducing fertility has such a powerful effect on economic development is that as fertility comes down, the proportion of the population that is economically dependent becomes smaller as the proportion of the population that is economically productive rises. So if you go back to thinking about that first graphic where you see the pyramid beginning to go like that, what that's showing is that the proportion in the young age groups is declining relative to the proportion in the middle age groups. If you then can empower that workforce to be economically productive, if you can somehow light that spark that produces economic takeoff, you've got a situation in which a country really can begin to move forward. And they called this the demographic bonus. The demographic bonus is that window of opportunity that opens up as the fertility transition occurs. And it doesn't last all that long, because as the last of those pyramids showed, by the time you get to the modern state that we have today, you've got a relatively small number in the middle supporting a very large number at the top. The pyramid becomes somewhat inverted, so that the dependency ratio changes. And as we know in our own society and in all of the aging industrialized countries, the costs of supporting an old age population are enormous as we think about our own struggles with how we're going to finance Social Security and Medicare. And that's exactly what this is all about. How does a relatively modest sized workforce support the needs of an enormous growing old age dependent population? I'm going to come back to Asia on this question at the end. So what these guys said is the Asian miracle can be explained largely by the social policies in education and health, the economic policies in export-oriented, publicly subsidized industries, and a really effective population strategy that got you a population pyramid that took advantage of this demographic bonus, this window of opportunity that countries go through. And I can show you quite dramatically the difference between two countries today, which are at very different stages of this transition. And they are, some of you will be surprised to see, Iran and Uganda. Uganda is the prototypical sub-Saharan African country. I mean, I could have chosen any country south of the Sahara, with the exception of South Africa and two or three others. And the pyramid on the right would have looked pretty much the same as Uganda's does. The pyramid on the left, Iran today, is absolutely classic of what happened as the Asian tigers took off and exploded. That was Thailand in 1985. It was Indonesia today. It was Taiwan in 1975. It was Korea in 1975, where you've got this big bulge, the mouse going through the snake in the middle age groups with a relatively smaller young age-dependent population and still a relatively small old age-dependent population. The higher the ratio between the economically active population and the dependent population, the bigger the window of opportunity, the bigger the demographic bonus. So that is the difference. The left is East and Southeast Asia, the economic miracle countries. The right is Sub-Saharan Africa today. And the challenge for Africa, of course, is to go where Asia went a generation ago. You may be interested to know that in 1950, the GNP per capita of Korea was less than the GNP per capita of Ghana. So it's not impossible for Africa to think about emulating the East Asian model. But it also ain't easy. And there are, of course, cultural issues that one has to take into consideration. And time is too short and my knowledge too limited to really be able to go into that. So what I want to conclude with is to try to summarize what the lessons are from the Asian experience. The first one is, I believe, that reducing fertility and cutting the birth rate is not in itself enough to ignite economic growth. It is just as important to invest in education and healthcare, especially in ways that creates a skilled workforce, and to cut the infant mortality rate. Cutting the infant mortality rate is essential. People have to know that their children will survive before they will consider having fewer of them. It's also critically important to fashion a set of economic policies that make sense. And that, along with that, is a government that is capable of instituting, implementing those policies, and creating a stable environment in which those policies can play out over a reasonable period of time. So political stability is also a critical dimension, and it is perhaps the greatest challenge that Africa faces, where most countries have not really had the experience of political stability. And I want to say that those that have, Botswana, Ghana, Rwanda since the genocide, South Africa, of course, are countries which are showing real signs of economic progress, where political stability goes alongside sound economic policies and reasonable population policies. African countries are beginning to show real signs of life. And I should add that the region of the world which has had consistently the highest rate of economic growth over the last 5 years is Africa, notwithstanding China. I'm going to talk just for a minute about China as a special case, I will come to that sort of toward the end. So reducing the birth rate, socioeconomic development form a virtuous circle, each reinforcing the other. The wealthier and better educated a society becomes, the lower the birth rate, and the lower the birth rate up to a point, the faster a society develops. But it's possible to overshoot the mark. And this is where I want to come now on contemporary Asia, because it doesn't look all that different from contemporary Europe or increasingly contemporary North America. It's possible to drive birth rates down so far that old age dependency replaces youth dependency as a drag on economic growth. Japan, Korea, and very soon China are in that situation, and all of Europe is in that situation. In Europe, there is not a single country with a birth rate that approaches replacement level. Replacement level is about two kids. Their demographers say 2.1 because there's always some infant mortality, and so you need a little bit more than two children per woman to ensure population stabilization or replacement level fertility. There's not a country in Western Europe that approaches replacement level fertility. And most European countries are closer to one child per family than they are to two. This is not a revelation to any of you. I'm sure you've all been reading the press accounts of the demographic problems that Europe has been facing. Well, Japan looks like Europe in spades. Japan has a problem that is much more severe, and Korea. Both of those societies are right down around one child per family, and no matter what they do, they can't get that birth rate up. They've tried all kinds of incentives, state subsidies, and so on. So by the way, have the Russians and the French, and none of it seems to work very well. It's a real conundrum what to do to get birth rates up when they have become so low that the aging of the population is outpacing the capacity of the working age population to support it. China is really a special case because China instituted, through its one-child policy, the most draconian population program the world has ever seen. That started in 1982, and it's been going on ever since, with varying degrees of enforcement and effectiveness in different parts of the country. But on the whole, what China did from 1982 to the present is drive the birth rate down to about 5.5 or 6 children per woman, to now about 1.2 or 1.3. It is, alongside Iran, the most dramatic success story in family planning or population control that the world has ever seen. And I think that the Chinese economic miracle, which followed exactly the same formula that the Koreans and the Taiwanese had followed 20 years earlier, has been comparably successful. I mean, the 9 and 10% annual economic growth rates that China has been showing are directly related to the effectiveness of its population policy. But I think that China has severely overshot the mark. I think that and in fact, a lot of Chinese demographers think so too. The rigidity and the sclerosis of the Chinese political system has made the Politburo particularly resistant to hearing arguments from the scientific community that this policy has more than outlived its usefulness and that it's time to change. And they're heading for a demographic cliff, in my opinion. I think that 10 years from now, China is going to look like Japan. It's going to be an old, post-industrial, struggling economy, because there are going to be no young people to fuel this enormous economic engine that they've built, unless they turn to international immigration on a scale never before seen in human history. And it's highly unlikely that the Chinese will do that. I know that sounds dramatic, and the Chinese may, through robotics and other inventions and mechanisms, belie this prediction. But if demography is ever destiny, it seems to me that the Chinese are a wonderful case to follow closely over the course of the next decade, or perhaps more, let's say two decades, to see what happens. I think that they are really going to struggle. The Korean economy is already struggling. They've gone from growth rates of 6-8% annually down to 2%. They're struggling to maintain 1%, 2% at the moment. Part of that is just the global economic recession, but part of it also is that it's a very old workforce with very few young people coming into it. And one of the great differences between our country and all other countries, including those in East Asia, is our much more liberal immigration policies. We have managed to offset below replacement fertility on the part of the majority population in this country by permitting immigration to the extent that we don't have that same kind of workforce limitations so far. The reason that the United States is the only industrialized country in the world that is not below replacement fertility is because of the fertility behavior of our Hispanic population, pure and simple. And that fertility is a one generation or two generation phenomenon. By the time immigrants reach the third generation, they behave just like everybody else in the society. And so that's what's going to happen with the Hispanic population of the United States. But right now, we are benefiting not from illegal aliens. We're benefiting from the high fertility of perfectly legitimate Hispanic Americans living in the United States. And that's keeping our workforce at a level that, right now we've got a structural unemployment problem that is related to the economic recession. But we have a workforce that is capable of refueling this engine in a way that the Japanese don't. And the Koreans don't. When the opportunities for economic growth return. So that's kind of my look at Asia's future. It seems to me that the role of demography in the economic success of Asia is, to my mind, indisputable. I think that the Harvard work on age structure has pretty much nailed the causality question. We used to be skeptical of whether this association was causal. I think that the age structure explanation makes it pretty compelling that where that window of opportunity opens, it creates economic growth opportunities that are unique and very special. And Asia cashed in. Latin America never has. Latin America has gone through the demographic transition. Only Brazil and Chile really have been able to benefit significantly from it with sound economic policies. Argentina has had just economically disastrous policies. Same with much of the rest of Latin America. Mexico looked at times as if it might really be able to cash in, but they've got such terrible problems now with narco terrorism and so on that is very hard to focus on strong, sound economic policies. But it's interesting to me the contrast between Latin America and East Asia, because demographically, Latin America looks very much like East Asia, and economically it looks very different. It sort of underscores the point that demography creates a demographic bonus, but you've got to do the other things in order to cash in on that bonus to really make it effective. I'll conclude with that, and would love to hear your questions or your challenges or your comments or anything else. Why don't we start? Jenny.
Steve, I remember, correct me if I'm wrong, I remember in your talk last year that you said something about that the 7 billion person was going to be born last fall, which apparently was in India, mm-hmm. and that this planet was really only made to hold 6 billion.
No, I didn't say that.
You didn't say that.
I didn't say that. I did. The first part of what you said, I did say.
Okay.
Yeah. The question of how many people the planet can support is one of unending debate. And whereas I think the debate about how and the debate about whether are close to being resolved, the debate about how many isn't. And there's a wonderful book by a demographer at Rockefeller University named Joel Cohen, called How Many People Can the Earth Support, that goes into that looks at the whole range of views on this question, and finally says at the end there is no answer. It depends on so many things. It depends on what kind of quality of life you're prepared to support. It depends on how much you care about wildlife. It depends on whether you are an optimist or a pessimist with respect to renewable energy and sort of post-petroleum technologies. There's so many variables that we can't predict that I think it's sort of unknowable how many people the Earth can support. What I would say is that...
Yeah. Well, you have to turn it off.
Time to turn it off.
Well, we get to the nude pictures.
Now you get all my pictures.
didn't announce it was looking for a picture.
I'm going to put it to
that's dangerous.
Okay, so you caught me right in the middle of I was going to talk about global warming, whether global warming is going to give us an opportunity to address that question in a way that we have not been able to address it before. Hans?
Yeah, it's that, as we know now, we cut the base of the pyramid, the bubble grows.
Yeah.
Now, when it becomes a mushroom,
yeah.
What are we going to do with our social systems?
I study demography, not social systems. I mean, you've read, many of you, I'm sure, are familiar with Pete Peterson's book, and there's an enormous literature on this question. You're from Europe. You know that the Europeans have been struggling with this for a longer period of time than we have, as have the Japanese. And I don't think anybody has figured that one out. So don't ask me to give you the answer to that question. I mean, I think that there is a limit to which you can tax a workforce, particularly one that is shrinking relative to the dependent population. Real limits to how heavily you can tax that workforce. I think that there are some ways in which you can address the question. One is by extending the working life of individuals, and that's beginning to happen in many countries. The mandatory retirement age at 60 or 65 is now moving to 70 and 75. And when people say that 70 is the new 50, that's a reflection, of course, of what's happened to life expectancy and years of productive life. I mean, clearly, many 70-year-olds are able to still work very productively today, whereas that wasn't true even 30 years ago. And so I think that simply prolonging that period of time is an important part of the answer to the question. The other side of the equation, of course, is how much of a social net should the state be required to provide, and to what extent should individuals throughout their productive lifetimes be responsible for creating for themselves that net? Those are political debates that could enliven this session for the next 48 hours or more. But I do think that prolonging our definition of a working life is part of the answer. There was a question. Okay.
I love this topic. It is really interesting.
Thank you.
I was just thinking about, I met a woman one time from the University of Maryland, and she was an insect person, and her focus was termites. She told me that the termite population reduces itself in a particular community, colony, if it doesn't need the numbers to keep it going, or it increases if it needs more termites to help build and feed itself.
Right.
Do you think that that human beings and population of human beings can be sort of self-correcting, like the animals and the insects and so forth, leaving aside all the politics and the welfare and all that stuff, it's just pure population increase and reduction?
I think to some extent that's what we've observed over the last half century. I think that when the world realized around 1950 that it had an unsustainable population explosion going on, it did mobilize in interesting ways to respond to that. And I think that some of you might leave this talk thinking that my conclusions are pessimistic, but there is a very optimistic side to what I've said, which is that I think that you could call the global response to the population explosion one of the most successful examples of international cooperation in our lifetimes. Because we have brought about a really remarkable demographic revolution in most of the world over this period from, let's say, 1965 to the present day. There are places where it's unfinished, but there are also places where we've been so successful that maybe now we need to think about other ways of addressing the low fertility problem. So yes, I mean, in a very broad sense and in a very inefficient way, the human race also has shown a capacity to respond. But we have all kinds of hang-ups about euthanasia and infant infanticide and things like that that termites don't have. We've got moral issues that really interfere with what would be the most efficient way of controlling population. And thank God for that.
So. Oh, this room would be on the way.
They don't kill them. They just don't have any more. You know them.
Yeah. I think that people do act in their own self-interest, and that if you make it possible for them to behave in a way that is really consistent with their self-interest, most of the time, in the aggregate, the right kinds of things turn out. And I do believe that the success of global family planning is a testament to that proposition. Jeff?
Steve, you made reference to China and their draconian.
I saw you start nodding when I said I'm going to talk about China in a special case.
The Southeast Asian countries, and having lived in Hong Kong through much of the period
that
you're referring to, etc., we saw that happening with the families, etc., particularly younger couples that we knew were definitely one child, two child, that's it. China, of course, introduced this one-child policy, which resulted in a predominantly male childbirth, which is causing a significant problem with your various pyramids there show almost right from top to bottom an equal number percentage of females to males.
I'm really glad you bring this point up.
In China, it's going...
It's very different. The Chinese pyramid would look very different. And so would India, for that matter.
That I didn't know. Yeah. Down the line...
And Korea does.
There's not going to have the women versus sustainable population growth, even if they wanted as population.
Exactly. It makes a bad situation that much worse.
And we saw this, we see this with these young princelings, as they are, because they're worshipped by their founders, etc.
Well, you know, unfortunately, the technology of ultrasound has made sex-selective abortion readily available right across Asia. And it has resulted in terribly skewed population distribution by sex, not only in China, but in Korea and in India as well. And in fact, in India, it is a crime. It's a felony to perform an abortion following an ultrasound examination. But nobody has, essentially nobody's ever been prosecuted. So it's a law without teeth. But the Asian countries are very much aware of son preference and the impact this has when you have a really strong desire or need to limit fertility. And I'm very grateful to you for bringing that up, because it compounds the Chinese problem, the lack of girls. Ralph, you had a...
Steve, tell me if I'm wrong, but it looks that the thread which connects the countries that have been relatively successful is a strong and stable, not necessarily democratic, political system, central government, because they can provide the education and public health services, the things that are required in order to make population growth under control. you didn't necessarily specifically mention that, but would you agree that that is almost an essential ingredient?
Yeah. I thought I had mentioned it, but I think I went past it pretty fast.
Yeah.
Probably, yes. It's on my list, actually, of essential conditions. Absolutely. The difference, I think, between India and Pakistan in the effectiveness of their population programs, let's say since 1980, is that Pakistan essentially has an utterly incapable central government, whereas India's government is pretty good at certain kinds of things. It's not as good as the East Asians, and the results in India are comparably not as good as those in the East Asian countries.
But I would think that countries which have very dominant tribal populations find it more difficult than those that have a central administration.
Yeah, I mean, maybe the classic case right now is Nigeria, where they can't. First of all, they don't have a strong central government. It's a highly federal system where the different regions, the different states are highly autonomous and very much in conflict with one another. But beyond that, you have tribal enmity that makes one tribe very resistant to family planning for fear that it will lose power relative to other tribes. This is an African problem, but it's not unique to Africa. It's also an Arab world problem. And it is, to some degree, an Indian problem. I mean, the Muslim population of India has much higher fertility than the Hindu population for fear of losing even further the power and influence that it has.
And isn't that also happening, particularly in some of the northern European countries where Muslims have established themselves in fairly large numbers and continue to reproduce at a greater rate?
Yeah, and I don't know whether Europe's experience with the reproductive behavior of immigrant populations is comparable to ours. I said in this country, within two generations, the immigrant groups tend to reproduce at about the same rate as the rest of the population, the majority population. I'm not sure whether that's true with these with the European countries that have experienced large-scale Muslim immigration. It may be. I just don't know. Yes?
You mentioned robots.
Robots.
Okay. The main, as far as I know, the main robot manufacturer in the world is a Japanese company named FANUC, or FANUC.
Yeah.
And that is in Japan, where they have a problem of not enough in the working force as opposed to the retired. And just recently, apparently Foxconn in China, who is that big manufacturing, has
makes all of our smartphones.
Yes. And they have just bought about 1 million robots, and I think from FANUC. So that they're preparing for that population shift.
Right. I mean, that's why I'm reluctant to predict that China's going to fall off that demographic cliff, because it may be that robot technology will so replace the human workforce that we're gonna go into a brave new kind of world in which human beings don't do those kinds of things anymore. They do other things. I don't know. I think that robotics, that mechanization, may in fact be something of a solution, but so far it hasn't been. I mean, the Japanese are the world's leaders in robotics. It's not doing them a whole lot of good in terms of restoring economic growth.
No, but
not yet.
It helps. It's got to help.
It does, particularly a country that absolutely will not allow immigration. Sylvia,
I would like to bring the little bit of conversation back to the problem of birth control. You did tell a story earlier on about the women hiding pills in the tent or in the hut, and the use of long-term contraceptives. injectables. When I was consultant to the University of Pennsylvania to a special clinic called Teenage Obstetrical Clinic, where we had a lot of recidivism, our problem was not with the young women and the girls using birth control afterwards. Our problem was with their men. And I wonder if you had any programs that you used in India or wherever that address this, that were helpful.
Yeah, another great question. I'm really very. I think you're asking wonderful questions. Thank you. The answer is yes, but we haven't been terribly successful. By far the most effective programs of changing male attitudes are those that are invented by wives. What happens at the early stages of a demographic transition is that women get interested in controlling their fertility. And as I said, often they have to do it surreptitiously because the men, and whether it's true, whether you're talking about West Philadelphia or Burkina Faso, the phenomenon is the same, are resistant. They think that birth control challenges their manhood. And in some cases, challenges their economic status and their social status within a community. I mean, for an African man to have a large number of children is an incredible status symbol. It is a form of wealth. And to tell them that they should have fewer of them, unless you can give them a really good reason why they should have fewer, it can be futile. So efforts to persuade men to have fewer children generally have not been very effective. And I can't say that we've been highly imaginative or put a lot of resources into that. But where it's been tried, it just hasn't worked very well. What does work is that after a period of time, the men begin to change their attitudes to correspond to what the women are actually doing. The women, instead of having a pregnancy every year, start having a pregnancy every 3 or 4, or then it becomes 5 or 6 years. The men adapt to that. And what you find in the middle stages of the transition, in the early stages, you have the attitudes of men and women when you do surveys on how many children do you want and do you approve of family planning. Attitudes are a mile apart. The women say, I want to have 3 kids, 4 kids, and yes, I approve of family planning. The men say 6 kids, and no, I don't approve of family planning. By the time you get to the middle stages of the transition, the attitudes begin to coincide to a much greater extent until you come to the contemporary post-transition society, where they tend to coincide almost precisely. Why that happens and how male attitudes change as female behavior changes, we don't really understand very well. And trying to develop messages or arguments to get men to behave differently don't seem to work terribly well. So the focus always of family planning programs has for that reason been on women. There are two reasons why the focus is always on women. The female reproductive tract is a lot easier to intervene in than the male reproductive tract. Therefore the contraceptives developed have been overwhelmingly female methods rather than male methods. And the second reason is that male attitudes are just so different from female attitudes that women are already predisposed, already motivated to control their fertility in ways in the pre-transition society men aren't. Okay, we're at second question time. Let's go to Jeffrey first and come back to you.
Total figure. I mean, one reads in the newspapers or what have you, the media, alarmist stories about the population growth. The worldwide population in 1950, what was that? What is the worldwide population in 2000, and where are we now? It is, based on what you're saying, what I've seen, it is slowing down. The growth rate is slowing down, but it's still a pretty alarming increase.
Yes. In 1950, the world population was 3 billion. and today it is seven. So over a period of 60 years, roughly, we've added 4 billion to the population, whereas it took 20 millennia to get from to the third billion. The first billion we reached, I think, in the 1830s. The second billion was around 1910. The third billion was 1950. And so the curve was going like this.
But it is flattening out now.
It is flattening out now. But we're going to get to 9 no matter what we do. There's no way to avoid 9 short of catastrophe. The question is whether we'll stop at 9 or keep on going beyond 9. My own feeling is that we won't go much beyond 9. That the flattening out that's happening will continue across those parts of the world where it's still growing. The reason it's still going up is that even when the total fertility rate reaches 2, in a country where it's happened very rapidly, like Iran, for example, there are so many more people still entering the reproductive age groups than leaving the reproductive age groups or than dying, that you have what's called population momentum. You still have an awful lot of births occurring, even if couples are only replacing themselves, because there are just so many of them who a generation ago didn't exist. When you've got that huge bulge at the bottom of the pyramid reaching the reproductive age groups now, even if the fertility rate of those people is much lower than their parents, they're still producing an awful lot of children in the next couple of generations. So that's why the built-in momentum of previous high fertility, even if fertility were to go to zero today on a global basis, would result in population growth going on for another 60 or 70 years at least. I think we'll reach 9 billion somewhere in the between the middle and the third quarter of the current century. And there it will probably. So in answer to Ginny's question, how many people can the world sustain? We'll find out, because we're going to be 9. Yes, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay. I was just wondering if you didn't show a pyramid in the United States, did you?
No.
What would the pyramid of the United States look like 10 years from now? I'm thinking that there are a lot of people being born, Hispanic group and so forth. There's a lot of people being born, a lot of African-Americans being born.
Nope, not African-Americans. Mm-hmm. You're wrong about that.
No.
African-American fertility is just about the same as non-African-American
fertility.
Well,
not fertility. In Trenton, I guess, but yeah. But anyway. So are they projecting what the pyramid
Oh, sure.
Look
I mean,
like?
We. Yeah, they are.
For us?
Yes. The pyramid in Europe is going to look much like what Hans talked about, a mushroom. It's going to be narrower and narrower at the base and bigger as you go up. The U.S. pyramid is going to look much more like this, a column, as long as we remain at replacement level. Because, I mean, you talk about the high fertility of particular groups, but that's offset by the very low fertility of other groups. Caucasians in this country are reproducing much like Europeans are. Our total fertility rate among white Americans is somewhere around 1.4, whereas Hispanic fertility is around 3. And so you have the high fertility, and that's why you read headlines in the paper that say, for the first time there were more non-white than white babies born last year. The Census Bureau says why California will or already is a white minority state, and many others are. The demographic profile of the United States is changing dramatically, but the age pyramid is changing very little. because of these offsetting factors. And I think that is, whatever you may feel about racial balance, that's a very good thing from an economic, from the standpoint of economic prospects. We're in much better shape in terms of where we could go economically. Not saying where we will go, but where we could go economically with sound economic policies and some degree of consensus in Washington about what those policies should be. We have much better prospects than Europe or most of East Asia because of our relatively column-like age structure.
See, in the developed countries, does the cost of living have any influence over the population growth?
I don't know. You would think so. I mean, the cost of children rises, and in surveys that people do, surveys I've seen in Europe, the argument that young people give for not getting married is that it's too costly to have children. And European fertility is not necessarily directly linked to marriage or vice versa. But generally speaking, when a European couple decides to start a family, the likelihood that they will become married is much higher. And marriage rates are very low in Europe, corresponding to very low fertility rates that correspond to the perception that children are just too expensive. And you do get that in surveys. Not so much here, although it clearly plays some role.
Well, I know when I went to college, tuition was, I mean, college was $600. Today it's what, 40,000, 45,000,
50.
50 if you include room and board and okay. Books and all that. That I would think would be a limiting factor for an awful lot of people.
Well, I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
I'm sure it is. But I just, you know, there is a lot of research on this, and that's just not a part of the field that I've spent a lot of time studying. So I can't really answer that. George?
Obviously, our population of 300 million people must have come about to a certain extent because of demographic movement of people coming in. And is that happening in East Asia as well?
No.
No.
No. There's virtually no in-migration in East Asia, except temporary labor migration.
But what about out?
there's less and less out-migration because the economic opportunities within East Asia are so good. There was, of course, at one time, tremendous out-migration from East Asia. Even after the economic miracle started, I mean, very large numbers of Koreans continued to come to this country up into the 80s. But if you look at it now, it's a trickle. And generally speaking, that's true. I mean, almost all of the immigration into the United States at this point is from within this hemisphere. There was a tremendous Asian immigration in the last two decades, but not much nowadays. I mean, there's a huge Vietnamese immigration. That's pretty much finished. And a lot of Chinese before that, and that's not much of that anymore either. Yeah, employment opportunities plus our security-based immigration policy just make it a lot harder for anybody to come to this country right now. Well, I don't see any more hands. You've been a great audience. I love your questions, so thank you very much.